was talking about the Anunnaki, and he's like, I know a lot about the Anunnaki. And so we figured, why not have a little podcast about the Anunnaki? Because, you know, and some of you might be like, what the hell is an Anunnaki? They took Homo erectus and their DNA and did a little petri dish experiment and created us. But the other interesting thing, proven in our genome, when they actually look through our DNA, mm-hmm. is that one of our chromosomes to the next actually show a hybrid fusion. Yeah,
I think it's interesting also how we see so many representations of this hybridization in so many different cultures.
That is mind-blowing for many people, you know?
Yeah,
absolutely. We were made as slaves to mine gold. To the Anunnaki real quick, okay? So one of the things that have always got me, and I don't know if it's gotten you, is that I'm a person that tries to put together little things, and sometimes things just don't add up, right? And there's been a lot of things in our history that do not add up, right?
Sure, absolutely.
And, you know, one of the things that, you know, when in studying many different forms of spirituality, I like to look at different types of religious texts and things like that. And like, you know, in the book of Genesis, let's just take that. Like, one of the things that always got me was, why before the Noah's Ark flood was all of these people ruled, and they use the word ruled, for 3,258 years. And then this person, 2,400 in this. And this one, like, you know, 4,000, 3,000, 2,000. But anyways, they're all in the thousands.
Right. It's something that's just absolutely bizarre for our current understanding of somebody can rule.
And there's been these forums and things that have went out, because then after the Noah's Ark flood, everybody lives with normal lifespans. It's like 87 years, 75, 92, blah, blah, blah. And so it was always interesting. And one of the bigger things in some of the forums is like they said, well, they must have measured the years different back then and blah, blah, blah. But it was like, it's the same book accounting for the same things. And why would they change their measuring system, right? And so that was always something that stood out. It's a little weird. The other thing is like Homo erectus to like Homo sapiens. They've never found the genetic link between,
that missing link, right?
Exactly. You know, and so it's like, okay, you go from like pretty much like these caveman type people to these sophisticated beings. Interesting.
And rather short period of time, too.
And like
ridiculously short.
Ridiculously
comparatively.
Short. And then, you know, like the pyramids. How the hell are they built? And then, but it's not even just the pyramids, like the old site of Babylon or these different other cities that have these huge, massive pillars that are four stories tall or more that are perfectly carved and the different things. And how the heck did they get them up there? And they put more things on top of it with what force?
How?
Yeah. How did that happen? How did the pyramids get built? Still things that baffle scientists today, engineers today. Okay. And then you go a little bit further on some of these things is like, you know, one of the things that always baffles me is like we have 64 codons in our DNA and only 20 of them are turned on. Interesting. Okay. And so, I mean, you keep on going. Why do we value gold over all other minerals? Why did it become the most valuable force? Right. And so there was
where
all these,
we learned this behavior.
Yeah. Where did we learn this? Where did we get this? And so, you know, like, and in studying, there's this, the theory of the Anunnaki, and they came back, they were, you know, 200,000 years ago, you know, and the theory goes that theory is kind of irrelevant because it's written about on clay tablets that it's there, you know,
it's
so
their testimony.
The Sumerian culture. And it's right there. And they talk all the accounts.
In cuneiform and everything.
And you know, even in the book of the Bible, I mean, in the book of the Bible, they say, you know, in the gods made man of us, but not, and in the likeness of us, but not us.
Right.
And there's a plural there talking about God, but it's us. And then in the likeness of us, but not us. Okay, so the theory goes, or the written texts describe that the Anunnaki came down, they started mining for gold because their ozone layer was getting thin, and if they could blast the gold into it, it could stabilize it and could create a warming climate. That's what it says in the fucking text. And so they come down, And they weren't that much more advanced than where we are today, 200,000 years ago, but they were slightly more advanced than we are today. So I'm thinking they're orbiting around every 3,600 years. They say another blue planet, and they have some kind of technology that tests that there's gold here. And when they're close to us, take their space shuttles, land on our Earth, just like we're trying to land on Mars and do stuff there. And they come down and they start mining for gold. And every 3,600 years, it gets picked up, right? And so, because they have these incredibly long lifespans of like hundreds of thousands of years, you know? And after a certain period of time, they don't want to keep on being down here mining for gold. And their civilization has advanced to the point where they can do cloning and genetically engineering. So they had a thing where they said, well, maybe we can make slaves to do the mining for us. And they took Homo erectus and their DNA and did a little petri dish experiment and created us. That's what it says in the text, in the tablets. I mean, it's a pretty interesting story to have written in a freaking clay tablet, don't you think?
I absolutely do. And I think it's interesting also how we see so many representations of this hybridization in so many different cultures that at that time, by our current understanding, these cultures should not have had contact with each other. I mean, if we look at some of the gods in Egypt, okay, we have Anubis, the jackal, you know, god, and we have in Hinduism we have Ganesh, who is the elephant, you know, headed god, and we have just all of these hybrid animals, or I would say almost kind of humanoid bodies with animal heads. It just is odd that every or so many at least culture would have had this understanding of this, and that this was something that could be done, even, because that's not really a presumed thought. At least that's not one I would have. Maybe I'm just different and weird. But for that to exist in so many different parts of the world that technically shouldn't have been in communication with each other, or having the same experiences, it does beg the question.
Yeah, and that they do these statues of these bigger beings with the animalmorphic head in the body, and I mean, what's the purpose of that? You know, if they look differently, or is that how they looked, right? And then, you know, so that's always a question. So then it goes a little further, and then they create us. And it's interesting because in the Sumerian text is the Adam and Eve story. It's slightly different there. They say that they make them, they have some horrible mutations that happen, and they say that they had mutations, they say that they had problems, that the human that they were creating didn't work right, or they had different types of defects. Yes. And they write about this, and then it took a while, and then they were sterile and they couldn't reproduce. And there was all of these things written in these texts. Again, I'm going to keep going back to that. And then, so they didn't do just one person and one person. They did seven men and seven women. Which makes way more sense when you think about it, because if you sleep with your brother or your cousin, you have a mutated baby, you know, and yet it was really weird that if all of humanity came from Adam and Eve, and then Adam and Eve would have to be sleeping with their daughters or their whatnot to create and procreate, talking about incest from the beginning, you know, I'm not trying to, you know, whatever, but it makes more sense that it was seven and seven, and it created this, you know, dynamic of these more gene pool that could continue to, you know, make these slaves. I mean, we were slaves.
Yeah, no, that's definitely the idea behind it. It's interesting. Again, this is something I don't personally know, but I am curious as to what the genetic deviation needs to be in order to dodge most of the genetic, hazards for kind of reproducing with each other. I'm wondering if it's like a seven iteration deviation. I don't know, but that would be very interesting to
find out. I wonder. But the other interesting thing, proven in our genome, when they actually look through our DNA, is that one of our chromosomes to the next actually show a hybrid fusion in it. And they say that that's only happens when people like mess with it, like in labs and stuff like that.
Oh,
but there's these two chromosomes that have this weird fusion that goes on in our DNA that is, looks like it has been scientifically messed with. And it's an anomaly that is in our DNA. This is stuff you can fact check. Go and look at it. It's there. Okay. And so with that being said, that's always bizarre. And the fact that that they only turned on 20 of our codons. Okay. Which I have a theory about that, of these enlightened beings that are going on and stuff. One, they try to make us so we wouldn't reach our potential, so that they could continue to have power over us.
But someone's stunting the growth a little bit.
Yes, okay. Completely stunting the growth. And I think as we activate more of these codons, we'll find ourselves having extremely longer life expectancies, being able to do telekinesis, doing other things. And I think that individuals that have been very enlightened or can do magical powers or different things like that, or have these other states of being, I honestly think that they just have activated an extra codon or something in their system.
And I absolutely think that's possible. I mean, I think that science is something that will always be very, it'll be very well done and executed when done, you know, properly. But I don't think that by nature, it's something that's supposed to simply be static. I think it, over time, with anything that has to do with life, it's going to change. It's going to morph. I don't think that this is something that you can just simply put a cap on and leave it that way. How many times have you had an experience of where you go to say something and you say it at the same time as somebody else, and there's that connection that's there? You feel like that also kind of draws you in a little bit closer, or that you have this certain thought of, oh my God, I need to call somebody, and you call and they're like, oh my God, this thing just happened to me. You know, I think these are little flickers of where we can go, what we have the capacity to do.
Yeah.
But it's been capped. It's like a little bit of light that's kind of escaped out.
Yeah.
But by and large, it is being suppressed to a certain degree. I don't think telekinesis is that wild of a concept.
Yeah. And I mean, and then we can go into the conspiracy theory of it, but I'm not even going completely there yet. I'm just talking about where this is and why this has these interesting facts that line up, or these coincidences that have been occurred in different stories or texts over time. That's all I was saying. And like, so with that though, like, I feel like there's so much more that gives me insight, and I'm like, there's so much more that we can tap into when we learn how to activate these other aspects of ourselves. But then if you go and you fast forward a little bit, so they created these humans. And one of the other aspects that are very much scientifically proven too, is after the Noah's Ark flood. Now, in the Sumerian text, it's I can't remember the name of the human that Aniki was in charge of the Earth project. Okay, so he had a brother that I forgot the brother's name, but the Aniki was like the good one that was in charge of the Earth project, and then he had the brother that had a little bit higher ranking. Do you remember the brother's name?
It's one of those things where, like, I probably would have said it and I just completely forget about it.
Okay.
I
think it starts with like an N or something.
He was definitely the least popular brother. That's why we don't remember it.
Then they knew that this planet was coming back around, their planet. And, we were having weather warming conditions on planet Earth.
Right.
And they, with how it orbited and their advanced technology, they knew that it was going to have a catastrophic,
catastrophic
event on our planet. And so they had a council meeting, or so it said in the text or whatever. And they wanted to just leave us all to die, because they weren't sure whether the planet would be habitable again after this event. And however, Aniki,
and they do sometimes go by slightly different variations from one culture to the next.
Yeah, so Aniki or Aniki or whatever, it's just said differently. Aniki, he goes and he writes down and shares with Noah. No, we know it as Noah, but again, I don't remember the other name in the other story, and shares how to build a ship, but really they talk about it being a submarine, to save and preserve humanity and some of the animals and things like that.
Right.
Which is interesting because that story gets retold as Noah's Ark and that whole story. So, but after that, where the science comes in, which is interesting, is that the water recited, they ended up settling where they the submarine or whatever washed up on shore in the mountain range, whatever. And as it settled and the people came, the story goes that they were actually the Sumerians, Aniki were, Anaki were up in the space watching the whole event, and they were in their spaceships, and they were happy to find out that the humans were saved and that the animals were saved, and that they came down and they saw that the planet could be reestablished, and that they knew that they had most of the population had all been wiped out. So they knew that they had to help them also
redistribute, repopulate,
and also, build some kind of sustainability, right?
Sure.
You know, because it was almost like they had this heart for them, for the, you know. And so in that period of time, that's where it's said in the Bible that they were given the gift from God, mm-hmm. of agriculture and pharmaculture, however it's worded. But the science behind it is the wheat, germ, and all these different seeds dated back in that time were hybrid seeds. This is the first time they're farming in all of history. They go from Neanderthal type of like artifacts and discovery to these people kind of artifacts and things like that. And suddenly they're the seeds that they're using to grow their crops. They thought that it would take the humans like 10,000 years to figure out how to do that hybrid. And here they are like making the hybrids, but that's because the seeds just came up from down up above, right?
Interesting.
So, and that was when the ruling actually got, you know, because you got to think most of the Anunnaki retreated back into outer space and out of the planet. So they weren't as
prior to the flood,
everybody left, right? So there was only some that stayed back. And so for the first time you're seeing after that the rulings were actually humans starting. And that's where the lifespans in this person ruled. And it was for such a shorter period of time.
Okay.
Because prior to that, it was the Anunnaki ruling. And then if you ever are familiar with this word in the Bible called the Nephilim, that is actually the species of, okay, so humans, Homo erectus, and Anunnaki. That human mixed with Anunnaki created a Nephilim. Nephilim.
Right.
And so the Nephilim were hybrids from human and Anunnaki. So they were more godlike.
Right.
And they
almost
had
like the titans of old.
Yeah. And one of the people, which was one of the first rulers prior to the flood and stuff, was Gilgamesh. Now Gilgamesh's tomb was just discovered in 2002. They found it.
I must have forgotten that. Okay.
And they went in and did this raid, military raid, took the tomb. And you're telling me they're spending millions of dollars doing this military raid, stealing the tomb. It's in the news. Check it out. Gilgamesh's tomb discovered. 2002, CNN, Fox. You see the articles when you Google. And then all they needed to do was test that for DNA and see that it wasn't all human. And you know what they said? We don't want to investigate it any further. I call bull on that. You don't go in and raid a country and steal a tomb and not DNA test it. The curiosity alone, I would be like, I just need to know, you know?
No, absolutely. I mean, that would definitely, I mean, just to even kind of confirm that this is kind of the person that you think that it is, or maybe even that, you know, in that same time frame, you're going to want to do that. I think to kind of give an answer such as we don't want to go further with it is saying that they already have gone further.
Oh yeah, and they can't tell
they don't want to really discuss it any further is what they want to do.
Yeah, which is interesting. So that comes up. Another thing that got discovered just recently was so when the Anunnaki came down, they settled in Mesopotamia, but where their first gold mine was in South Africa. Okay, so the southeast tip of Africa is where they were mining for gold.
Okay. Is this over like close to Madagascar, or are you referring to Madagascar, like the kind of southeastern side of continental?
Southeastern Africa. Side of the continental.
Okay, gotcha.
Okay, so
gotcha.
As a continent, not as South Africa, right? So, and then what that place, they found just recently these weird formations that form these weird grids all over that date back, get this, 200,000 years. And what some scientists say is that they have this weird, interesting, remember, this is very advanced civilization, but they have this weird, they have something to do with sonic resonances. And they have the ability to be used for mining, and specifically, they have this resonance of gold. So they just discovered the gold mines from 200,000 years ago. The other interesting, that was where they first genetically altered their slaves. Guess where they have traced our mitochondria? They have taken a human mitochondria and they've went back in to see where it can trace.
Right.
The same location in Africa. Interesting. Like right by where the gold mines are that they discovered.
That is a bit curious. Again, that does beg the question. That's really interesting that they did that mitochondrial study. Because, you know, that tends not to be how we think of our lineage. You know, we think of it as definitely more something that's patriarchal. But the mitochondrial DNA is passed down through the mother's side and only through the mother's side. So they're literally going back through the maternal lineage to be able to kind of find this, which I think that's a great, you know, way to kind of go back and look at. And it's a great way of exhausting all the options and opportunities. And yeah, why not check the maternal side as well as the paternal side?
Right. Isn't it fascinating though?
Yeah.
Right?
No, it absolutely is.
And it's like, and with all of this, it's like, it kind of begs questions of like, I mean, again, these are all the things that I found it was answering and checking off.
Sure.
I'm not saying it's 100% with certainty, but I mean, it's a little interesting that there would be these texts that tell everything, but they're also very hidden and not talked about much, and because they would stir up a lot of belief systems, right?
Absolutely.
I mean, here it is, like people have been worshiping the God, right? And in whatever culture, and they have designed their whole life around these certain religious texts and core values and belief systems. Mm-hmm. And suddenly there's these scientific evidence that points into the direction of these older texts that predate any of these biblical texts.
Right.
And that, you know, by many, many years, you know, and these tell a different story.
Absolutely.
They say in the text that they were given this by beings above. They specifically say that, like, not, you know, like these beings from above came and gave us this. They taught us this. They engineered us. They did all these things. It tells the story that aliens came here and created us. Now, that's a very different story than we evolved and had this spiritual kind of thing. And it doesn't mean that we are not spiritual. I totally believe in spirit. I totally believe in different connections. I think there's many different dimensions that are going on. And I think that there's many different higher beings and different varieties of life.
Sure.
Right? But for us in this physical incarnation, that is mind-blowing for many people, you know?
Yeah.
We were made as slaves to mine gold. If you like this content, make sure that you like, subscribe, and comment below. And we also have amazing link right there for some cool product. I know you want to check it out. I know you want to click it. Go ahead. Come on. You can do it. All right. Until next time, have a beautiful, blessed day.